Hello everyone and welcome to another CPU launch review video. This is the second round of AMD Ryzen 9000 series CPUs launching this week, which includes the 12 core 9900X and the 16 core 9950X. I've been running a bunch of benchmarks. I'm going to be sharing that data with you guys today. There are timestamps in the description if you guys want to jump ahead to any specific part of this video. But most importantly, a decision I had to make starting pretty early on was I'm not going to test this one. Today's video is brought to you by Thermaltake's EX series fans, featuring magnetic force connectors that can daisy chain fans together to simplify installation and cable management. CT120 EX fans feature solid all-around performance and a touch of tasteful RGB lighting. The SwaFan EX series revolutionized case fans by adding swappable fan blades, and the TuffFan EX Pro series sports best-in-class high static pressure for use with radiators and an aggressive all-black design. And all of them feature larger magnetic force connectors for easy wiring. For more on the EX series fans from Thermaltake, click the sponsor link in the video description. Fortunately, these boxes are pretty sturdy. I have a few notes for you guys before I dive into my benchmark results. My focus today is gonna be on the 9950X 16-core flagship processor. I did attempt to test the 9900X as well, but there's something of a known issue with the motherboard BIOSes that we have been testing with, and that is that the Infinity Fabric clock, the F clock, can be automatically set to 2100 megahertz instead of 2000 megahertz, which has a pretty negligible impact on actual performance, but can introduce instability. Unfortunately, I went through like half of my tests with the 9600X and 9700X last week before I realized that that F clock was running at 2100 megahertz. But since I wasn't encountering any instability, I decided to plow ahead rather than going back and retesting, which would have lost me a bunch of time. And that plan worked just fine until I tried to switch over to test the 9900X, and then I started to get some blue screen errors. And then my Windows installation got a little bit corrupted or wonky, and I had to do a fresh install of Windows. And anytime you encounter problems while doing early testing, you have to go through troubleshooting, and that takes away from your actual testing time. So at a certain point I decided, you know what, we're just gonna set the 9900X aside for now, and that allowed me to bring in the 5800X3D to give some comparison tests for that CPU as well. And it turned out that was a good call anyway, because there is something that works a little bit differently with scheduling and Windows with these Ryzen 9000 series CPUs, and you needed the chipset, Windows, and the CPU to all be working in harmony, and AMD found that swapping CPUs could actually mess that up, and they were recommending a fresh install of Windows between testing different processors, which, let me tell you, is not the most convenient thing to have to do when you're trying to run a bunch of tests to get comparative numbers. I am quite happy with the testing and the results that I got out of the 9950X, but the other side of the testing equation going into this launch was the big question mark around Intel and if they were going to be coming out with their microcode update for their 13th and 14th gen processors in time to get testing in to compare with AMD. If you're not familiar with any of the recent issues with Intel Raptor Lake processors, check out any of my recent tech news videos, but basically they've been encountering instability, and Intel promised a microcode patch that would supposedly fix these problems, which only just came out conveniently a few days before this launch was supposed to go live. So thankfully, I was able to get that patch in and run tests with the 14900K, so I have updated patched numbers for that. So my results you'll see today for the 14900K were tested with that updated 0x129 patch. But with all that stuff said, let's get into the actual review proper, starting with a look at the specs for the processors that I am testing today. The processors I'm testing today are the flagship 9950X with 16 cores and 32 threads, the predecessor Ryzen 7000 series 7950X, as well as the current best CPU for gaming, the 7800X3D, which maybe shares that crown with the 7950X3D, but I also threw in the last gen 5800X3D on the AM4 platform because I know a lot of people are rocking that, or possibly the 5700X3D, still a great CPU for gaming. And then of course we have Intel's current flagship, the 14900K, which is currently selling for $550. And note here that I have both the launch pricing and the current pricing for the CPUs listed. The 9950X is launching at a price that's $50 cheaper than the 7950X did, $650 versus $700, but in today's market, the 7950X is going for around $520. Here's a look at my testing hardware as well. I ran multiple test beds for multiple platforms for today's video, but most notably my AM5 testing was done on the ASUS Crosshair X670E Hero motherboard. And our current GPU of choice is the top end GPU that's available right now, the RTX 4090, represented by the Founders Edition 4090 straight from NVIDIA. And now let's take a look at my test results, starting with power draw, since efficiency is supposed to be one of the things that the Ryzen 9000 series CPUs are really good at. And we're looking at a range of metrics here, the peak CPU package power power across all tests, overall system power draw while running the Cinebench 2024 multi-threaded test, overall system power draw while running Blender, and gaming power draw, which is going to include the power draw of the RTX 4090 as well. Package power is down to about 200 watts for the 9950X, that's about 30 watts less than the 7950X, and over 50 below the 14900K. During the actual test, the 9950X was drawing about 100 watts less than the 14900K, which is pretty impressive, but the 14900K is not necessarily known for its efficiency. Compared to last gen though, the 9950X does see some improvements, about 10 to 20 watts less power drawn during Cinebench and Blender, but the difference during gaming was actually negligible pretty much, only about 5 watts. Next are some temperature test results, and this is after a 10-minute IDIS 64 burn test. So this does go beyond the temperatures you would typically see in day-to-day use, but even with the microcode patch, we are still seeing the 14900K regularly hit 100 degrees Celsius, and that means it's hitting a temperature limit, which is introducing some throttling, up to 18% throttling at max according to IDIS 64. The average temperature looks a little bit better here for the 14900K, but that was varying wildly depending on whether or not throttling was happening. It would go between 80 degrees Celsius and 100 degrees Celsius, so pretty inconsistent there, and I would say the microcode patch has not magically fixed the 14900K's temperature issues. The 9950X though does see some nice improvements in terms of peak temperatures compared to the 7950X. 7950X would regularly get up to that 95C limit, but the 9950X was running at about 86.4C average temperatures. The control temp sensor peaked at 89.4, and we did see the CCD hotspot on CCD2 get up to 95.1, but still we are generally seeing 5 to 10 degrees Celsius lower temperatures for the 9950X, so that's impressive considering that it did outperform the 7950X at the same time. Of course, if you then throw in the X3D CPUs, you'll note that they are doing it just a fine job, especially for gaming, as we'll see in a moment, and they are able to run at much lower temperatures. So if gaming is your focus, and this will be further shown in the gaming benchmarks, the X3D CPUs are absolutely still the way to go. We're gonna start with compute tests though. This is Cinebench R23, giving our CPUs 16 cores and 32 threads a little bit more to work with. Where I have extra comparative numbers, I will throw them in you guys for some of the other CPUs that are beyond my 5 CPU main focus for this video. And here the 9950X had the top score of 41,468. That's about a 10% improvement over the 14900K and about 8.5% ahead of the 7950X. Here are the R23 single thread scores. This is another area where the 9000 series was supposed to have a nice big jump, and we can see that here, 2280 was the score for our 9950X, which is more than 200 points above the 7950X, but it was still shy of the 14900K, which was 2.5% faster. Switching over to Cinebench 2024, the 9950X had a multi-core score of 2280, again leading the pack, more than 5% ahead of the 14900K, while the 7950X was behind by about 8%. Here are the single thread scores as well, but here the 9950X was able to take the lead in single thread performance with a score of 140, 2 points ahead of the 14900K, putting it about 1.5% ahead. We also had a nice improvement over the 7950X, which was 13% behind. Here's our last synthetic, CPU Mark 11, which is part of the Passmark performance test. Once again, the 9950X took the lead. 67,146 was the overall score. That puts the 14900K behind by about 7.8% and the 7950X behind by about 5%. Here's a look at the single thread scores in that test, and again, the 14900K was able to maintain its lead, but very, very marginal one, only 2% ahead with 4,897 over the 9950X's 4,796. Here's a set of Blender render tests using Blender 4.2.0 and the Open Data 3.1 benchmark, which runs the Monster Junk Shop and Classroom tests, and we're looking at cumulative samples per minute, so higher is better. Again, the 9950X had the lead with 600.2. That put the 14900K about 17% behind, and the 7950X about 10% behind. And next we have video transcoding with Handbrake 1.6.1. Here's one of the few tests where Intel took the lead with an encoding speed of 78.2 FPS, which tops the 9950X by about 12.8%. The 7950X was just about 1% behind here, and as with all of these tests that are leveraging all of the cores and threads of the CPUs, our 8-core 7800X3D and 5800X3D are pretty far behind. Next test is the Corona 10 renderer, which outputs a score in rays per second. Once again, 9950X has a top spot with 14,757,448 rays per second. The 14900K is about 20% behind in this test, and the 7950X is about 13% behind. Here's the 7-zip compression and decompression benchmark. The 14900K and 9950X somewhat traded blows here, with the 14900K taking a 2.5% lead in the compression test, but then falling behind by a little less than 17% in the decompression test. And now we transition over to gaming tests with one more synthetic, which is 3D Mark times by Extreme. Here you can see that running a 4K test where we're not CPU limited, you have similar graphics scores across the board for our RTX 4090, and that is part of the reason the rest of the tests I'm going to be sharing today will run at 1080, which shows more of a difference in performance from CPU to CPU. However, we can see a difference in the CPU focus part of this test, where the 9950X had the top score of 12,820, with the 7950X coming in less than 1% behind, and the 14900K just over 6% behind. Let's dive into our proper game testing with Shadow of the Tomb Raider, where many cores and threads don't always necessarily give a CPU advantage. It's more about instructions per clock, single thread performance, and if you're looking at those X3D CPUs, having a nice big cache to work with. The 14900K took the win in this test though, 267.4 average frames per second, puts it about 7.3% ahead of the 9950X, while the 7950X was about 2% behind, but it's really the X3Ds here that are coming out on top and showing why there's a lot of people waiting for like the 9800X3D, and with good reason potentially. Even the two generations old now 5800X3D outscored the 14900K and the 9950X in this test. Next up is Cyberpunk 2077, a similar story here where the 9950X barely edges out last gen by just about half a percentage, so not that much of an uplift here. The 14900K is still beating both of them by about 3%, but the 7800X3D is really the top dog here, 13.4% ahead of the 9950X. And again, even the 5800X3D showing some excellent performance. Here's Total War Warhammer 3, trying to mix things up beyond the typical FPS titles. It's a different kind of game, but a similar story with the 9950X outperforming the 7950X by about 3%, but then the 14900K topping the 9950X by about 7.4%, and then the 7800X3D winning once again 13.5% ahead of the 9950X. Here's F1 2023, because I like to throw a racing game into the mix as well. The 9950X had a better uplift over the 7950X here. It was about 10% ahead, hitting 212.5 average frames per second. The 14900K did maintain the lead over the 9000 series CPU, about 3% ahead, but the 7800X3D comes out with the overall win once again. At the risk of repeating myself, the story is again very similar with Starfield. 9950X performance is improved over the 7950X by just shy of 3%. The 14900K is about 10% ahead, and the 7800X3D is about 11% ahead. Final game test is Microsoft Flight Simulator 2020, because people always tell me in the comments that they like when I test this title. An average FPS of 67.4 puts the 7950X about 6.5% behind the 9950X's 72 frames per second. One more time though, the 14900K does maintain the lead, just shy of 3% ahead, but the 7800X3D and the 5800X3D for that matter, showing that the 3D V-cache really is the way to go if you plan to do extensive gaming, especially at lower resolutions, especially if you're playing any kind of game where you might be CPU limited. And that rounds out the tests that I ran for this launch review, but now let's do the thing that people like to jump to from the beginning part of the video, which is the cumulative score results. Starting with the focus on the compute testing, and I'm using the 9950X here as the 100% baseline, and here is where the 9950X is going to shine the most, because if your focus is on compute performance and you don't mind paying a bit of a premium for the new CPU that just launched, and you appreciate a bit of added efficiency over last generation, the 9950X was 7.5% faster than the 14900K, and it also maintained a lead over the 7950X, which was only about 6.3% behind. Likewise, here is where, if you're comparing to the X3D CPUs, you can see that all of the cores and threads of the 16-core 9950X can do a lot more outside of gaming workloads and can save you a lot of time versus opting for one of those 8 cores, again, if gaming is not your focus. If gaming is your focus though, oh wow, the 9950X really probably isn't the CPU for you, mainly because of what the 7800X3D offers. That is the CPU in this lineup that I would point you towards if you say, I don't really need all that CPU compute performance, but I do want to get the most out of my RTX 4090, 4080 Super, or a high-end graphics card along those lines. The 9950X does show some uplift versus last generation. The 7950X was about 4.1% slower. However, it could not catch up with or overtake the 14900K without the benefit of the X3D V-cache. The 14900K was still 5.6% faster in my CPU limited 1080 testing. But even the 5800 X3D was 1.6% faster than the 9950X, or the top dog, 7800 X3D was 15.3% faster. Here's one final look at the average frame rate across all the games, aligned with the current price for all of these CPUs to provide you effectively with a cost per frame. This is focused specifically on gaming, I should point out, but once again, the X3D CPUs are showing both their value and their performance at only $1.76 per frame. But here's also where some of AMD's best competition comes from themselves, because thanks to the price drop since launch for the 7950X, even it is more aligned with the 14900K in terms of cost per frame here, versus the price premium that you'd have to pay for the 9950X. So the 9950X is a reasonable choice for anyone who is very focused on CPU compute performance, someone who wants a bit of added efficiency over the 7000 series, and someone who I guess doesn't mind paying a bit of a premium for a product that just launched. Those things aside though, the 9950X doesn't make much sense for anyone who is budget conscious, especially if you're comparing this to the other well-priced options on the market, especially from the 7000 series. And I think anyone who is looking at the 9950X launch and who is maybe disappointed might be disappointed because of some of the promises that AMD made when they first talked about these CPUs back at Computex, especially in terms of the IPC uplift and how much of an expectation they gave us in terms of the performance from 7000 series to 9000 series. It is there, it is not negligible, but it's made very difficult to recommend because of the current price, and it's made especially very difficult to recommend for anyone who is focused on gaming or looking for mixed use simply because there are so many other viable options out there right now. I, for one, will be looking forward to the inevitable price drops, sales, and discounts on the 9950X, which will bring that cost per frame proposition much more in line with the other high-end CPUs on the market. And, like all of you guys, will be eagerly anticipating the 9800X3D, or maybe 9950X3D, to see how that performance lines up with the added advantage of 3D V-Cache, which we know is coming, hopefully sooner rather than later. But that wraps it up for this video, my launch review of the AMD Ryzen 9 9950X CPU. If you enjoyed this video, hit the thumbs up button. You can also check out the video description down below for links to these CPUs, as well as some of the other testing hardware that I worked with. And if you enjoyed this video and you want to help support my channel, don't forget to check out my store at paulshardware.net, where I have lots of high quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Thank you guys so much once again for watching this video, and we'll see you all in the next one.